Yeah, can you see my screen?
Yes.
So yeah, basically whatever you have in your kitchen, those will be probably, some will be wet, some will be dry. So you need to crush them. So anything, if you have to dye, you basically have to make the material smaller so that you can boil them. The main method of color extraction is by boiling the material. First, crushing it if it is very hard, or if you can do it in a mixer, or if it is flour or something, then you can just crumble it with your hands. If it's very hard, like something like hartiki or walnut shells, you know, then you can actually soak them in water overnight, and next day you can crush them. Usually anything, if you soak it in water, it starts oxidizing and degrading, so the colors actually change. So we don't recommend soaking too many things. The dry and powdered part is the best part, or just breaking into smaller parts is the best part to work with. So in your kitchen, what kind of dyes you think you can get from? Shefali, can you mention what can you?
Yeah, turmeric, turmeric and a cinnamon. Sorry. Yes, and I think onion peels.
Yeah. So brown onion peel, not the light onions. Light onion peel don't give color. Okay. Dark pink or dark brown, they are the ones which give color. And in this picture, if you see on the right hand side, this is dried pomegranate peel. Okay, this one on the right side. So taking out color from fresh material is not very effective. Okay, if you sun dry it and then you, you know, crush it and then you boil it, that's much better. Even the second one, the center one, is kesura, or the flame of forest flower. Okay, and I don't know what is called in other places, but flame of forest is an orange color flower. This is also dried and then it is used. Okay. So I'll show you both the things. The wet part is good to see if there's some color or not in that ingredient. But when you want to use anything for a dye purpose, you should actually dry it. And this third one is madder root, which is, you know, it gives this red color. So I'll show you. So you can actually forage. First, what you can do is if you can try and see what are the things that you can get from your garden or kitchen. Okay. How do you see whether it's got color or not? Suppose haldi, you know it has color. But what if you did not know, you know, which one to use? Then what do you do? So here, I'm just going to show you a video of things. What you do is you collect the material, whatever you're getting, and you take a small beaker or something and you pour some hot water, really hot water on it. Okay, and leave it for some time. And then this is how, I'll show you some of the people who foraged, how did their material look like. So these were like some flowers, this was grass, and then this was something, blue pea flower, this was some leaves that were there in the garden, this was some other flower. So the idea is that you soak everything in hot water just to check if that material has a dye property or not. Okay. So that is the first.
So thing. Namrata, so do they need to first dry everything, like even those leaves and things?
When they are checking, then you don't have to dry anything. So the first step is to check if a material has color or not. For that, you can just bring that material, put some hot water over it, leave it for some time, and then drop a piece of fabric in it and see if the fabric is catching color or not.
And so how can we get that green color if we dry the leaves?
No, so we're not drying right now. When we make a dye, then we have to dry. Right now, we're just checking whether this material has color or not. So the first step is investigating whether the material has color or not. For that, you can just get fresh items. You can put it in a beaker or a small bowl and pour some hot water, leave it for half an hour, 1 hour, and then put a piece of wet fabric, small wet fabric in it, and check if it is catching color or not. Okay. This is the investigation part. We're not yet doing dyeing. We just want to know that whatever we are finding in our garden or kitchen, does it have color or not? Is that clear?
Okay. I would just check with Dimple. I'm sorry, Namrata, that since she got dropped off. Dimple, are you able to follow us now?
Yes, I am following you. Though I haven't got the material because, as I told you, he is positive and I did not want to step out of the house.
Sure.
So that's not a problem. Actually, even Shefali doesn't have materials. So what we have decided is Namrata is going to give you a demonstration, explain you everything, and we'll share the recording. So at later stage, you can at home, you know, practice by yourself.
Yes, definitely.
Okay. So and feel free to ask anything if you have any questions.
Sure.
So all these items can have color. Don't think that only flower or leaf or only you know, some berries can have color. There are bark roots also. So you can actually explore about in the kitchen or in the garden or wherever you find any of these things you find that you feel you want to explore if it has color. These are what you can look for. Okay. I've skipped this part. Just one moment. Okay. Tamanna is there.
Recording
happened. I'm not able to shift this. Okay. Some common sources of, so from your kitchen and garden you can explore. We are not sure whether everything will have color. Secondly, we're not sure if everything which has color is going to be is going to stay on the fabric or not, because many colors are come out very bright on the fabric when you boil them or drop them in the, you know, dye bath, but after washing they run off. So they can be fugitive colors, which means they will come but they will go very fast. So I'm going to share some sources of natural color which are absolutely surely going to give color. I just wanted to have a look at these things. You may not find them in your kitchen or garden, but if you want to do dyeing, you can actually source these things from the, you know, from online stores or something. Even in our store, it is there. Okay. And then I'll come back to how you can use what you have in the kitchen. Okay. So this.
And I think, Namrata, you guys have kits at Color Ashram of these dyeing materials.
Yeah. We do. It's called Natural Dyeing Kit, and you can buy in this. All these herbs are there, which are common sources of natural color. Now, these are sources which have been used for thousands of years. So, and they have been tested to have color. And whenever you boil, you can use them properly for color. So for yellow, this any kind of yellow flower, marigold, kesura can be used. For red, madder roots are used, which is also called manjishtha. And I think people use it in the puja as well. Okay. And all of these have Ayurvedic properties, and they were also used as medicine in olden days. Okay. Next is dhavri, which is a wood flower, which does not have a color of its own, but it can, when it is used with madder or with kesura, it can actually take out or brighten up the colors which are already there in the herb. Pomegranate peel is very, very famous for yellow color. Okay, and it also is a mordant in itself, which means it does not need a fixer. Harda or Myrabalam or Hartaki. You guys must have heard about it, right? Harda, Hartaki, Myrabalam, this picture which is there. Has anyone seen this or heard?
Harda, maine suna hai, but it's like brown and grayish color. Something.
Harda is used in Trifla.
Trifla,
so harda is one of the ingredients in trifla. Trifla mein aur bahut cheez hoti hai, amla hota hai aur bhi kuch hota hai. So harda is one. So harda is basically an Ayurvedic herb to treat any kind of colic illness, and harda is an excellent mordant, which means fixer. So it is one of the plant mordants which are available. Usually natural dyeing mein mineral mordants use karte hai, which is like alum and iron. But harda is one plant mordant which can be used for some colors. And harda ka rang agar usko boil karenge to yellow aata hai. So it is both a color as well as a fixer. And if you remember that Kalamkari fabrics have this yellowish base on the background. They're not white. They always light creamish yellow. Do you all remember seeing that?
Yes. Yes.
It's because all the Kalamkari fabrics are first treated with harda and buffalo milk, and then they are painted on.
Okay. So
the whole big fabrics are kind, you know, dipped in milk and harda, left it for some time, dried, and then the painting starts. Okay. So okay. This is how they do it. Okay. So these are what I'm talking about are the dye sources. So basically you need from nature, you need red, yellow, and blue, right? If you have these three colors, then you can probably mix and make more colors. I mean, the same concept of primary color wheel applies here. Yes. So we can get yellow from maximum things. Anything you crush, somehow yellow you'll get, which is most prevalent in nature. Second thing is the less available is red color, for which I mean madder is the one which you have to actually find. Not many colors have, you know, red. And then some other flowers may also give red color. Beetroot can give red color. But then the most rare is indigo. Right? Indigo is the one which gives blue color. Have you guys heard of indigo?
Yes.
Okay. So indigo
it's
is
for nail also.
A lot of these beauty parlors who talk about applying henna to hair,
right,
say you should add indigo to the henna.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So natural indigo was the only source of color which could be made into a blue dye. You do get some little bit of blue color from a thing like a blue pea flower or a berry or something, but it is such a small quantity and it's difficult to make it into a dye. For dyeing, you definitely only get blue from indigo, or there are varieties of indigo, like there's a plant called woad, W-O-A-D, that can also give blue color. So the reason why indigo was very precious, and if you know your history, if you study the history, you'd remember there was indigo revolt in the time of British, and indigo
Champaran.
Was considered to be, yeah, yes, Champaran. And indigo was considered to be the blue gold. Because it was from India, indigo was, you know, introduced to the whole world. And when British came to know about this blue color, because at that time there were no chemical colors and they did not have blue color in their palette. But indigo introduced this blue color. And since then, natural indigo was very, very treasured commodity from a country like ours. But today, of course, natural indigo is not so much in use because we have synthetic indigo, we have synthetic blue. All right. So, red, yellow, blue, if you have three colors, you can actually mix and make more colors. So we can get indigo, say blue mil jayega, red we can get from madder or some red flowers sometimes. And yellow you can get from maximum flowers, marigold, flame of forest or any other flowers. So indigo, making of indigo is like really, really difficult task. If you have time, go to YouTube and look for this film called In Search of Indigo. Okay, this is a film which is made and commissioned by Asian Paints. And it's a beautiful film that talks about how making of indigo is not just a dye and a process. It's absolutely a culture, it's poetry, and it's a very, very difficult thing which is only transferred from generation to generation. And that is true because indigo, like all the other things, you can just boil and take out color, right? But indigo doesn't happen like that. Indigo, if you boil the leaves of indigo, you will get nothing. You have to, the whole process of indigo is fermentation and then making a cake and then, you know, making a vat, which is a very difficult process to make it naturally.
Namrata, you need to tell the name of the film. I'll put it in the chat. And even yesterday also you mentioned
indigo. Yeah, yeah.
In search of indigo. Yeah. And there was one more film you had mentioned yesterday.
True cost. Yeah, true cost.
Okay, I'll put it in the WhatsApp group also.
Okay, good. Yeah. So we've got, we understand how we can get color from different plants. Now, what is the other thing that you need when you have to dye? What did we speak about yesterday? Besides the dye, what do you need? Can anybody remember and tell me?
Fixer.
Very nice. So the word, the term for fixer is actually called mordant in natural dye language. M-O-R-D-A-N-T. The one, I hope you guys can see this screen properly. Can you? Or should I enlarge it?
It's visible.
Okay, I'll just enlarge it as well.
It's visible.
Yeah, so mordant is a term, whenever you look up any internet, may you look it up, it'll be there, which is nothing but a fixer. And it is used to bind the natural dye with the fabric. Now, fabrics, when we talk about, they're normally cotton fabrics. And cotton means that it has a cellulose base. Anything which is coming from plants will have cellulose, right? You have to remember a little bit of your biology here also and chemistry also. But then there are some fabrics which can be protein based. For example, which are all animal fiber based. Can you name some fabrics which are animal fiber? Which are got from animals?
Leather?
Yeah, leather. Silk, wool. Yeah. Silk and wool also, right? So silk, wool, leather, all these things would have actually protein in them. So just remember that what is the content and the chemistry of the fabric will be very important for natural dye when you're doing that. So all the protein fibers of fabrics have more affinity, or they are very open to absorbing natural dye. But the cellulose plants or fiber are very difficult to dye because they don't hold the dye and the dye runs off very quickly. So the mordanting part is really important if you're dyeing a cotton fabric. And different mordants can actually give you different color. So some of the mordants that we're going to be using is, one is you can use Hartaki as a mordant. Second is you can use alum. And third is you can use iron. Alum and iron, when we go to mineral mordants, they are the safest to use. We'll not go towards copper and chromium. We'll stick to alum and iron. This is about normally what mordants are used. But now when I talk about in your kitchen, what do you have which is a mordant? So the way to find out is if the kitchen ingredients has tannin content or tannic acid in it. Okay.
I'm just going to salt. Salt can be used as a fixer?
Salt is actually used after dyeing for like fixing, but it's not really a good fixer. People use it, but it's not a fixer. Like, so mordant is something which you will use before you dye. So the first step of dyeing will be to soak the fabric in water. Then you squeeze it and then you put it in the mordant and you let the mordant be absorbed. And then you put it in the dye bath. That's a process we follow. So salt is really not helpful in that way here. Salt can be added. Sea salt was good actually, but we don't have sea salt. We have this iodized salt, which will not work so well. Rhubarb leaves and all that is also there, which you can use. So when I was just coming back to, like, when you do natural dye, you can have all these mordants, but if you're doing from the kitchen, how do you check? Then your ingredient, if it has tannin or tannic acid in it, it's a good mordant. Tea has tannin, Hartaki has tannin, rhubarb leaves have tannin, then pomegranate has tannin. So pomegranate peel, if you boil it and make a solution, then you'll also have color. So that is not good enough. The idea is actually when you're using anything like a mordant, you should not boil it too much because then it'll give color also along with the mordant quality. So try and use less of it, or you can just soak it in the water and then use it like a mordant. Okay. So now you can actually use tea if you have in your kitchen, and then you can use pomegranate peel. You can make boil it in water and make a solution that will act like your mordant. And what else can you use? Hartaki, I don't think you'll have. So yeah, let's stick to tea and pomegranate peel. Okay. These two things you can start with. And using proper mordants for natural dyeing, we'll come to when you do a course on understanding, you know, how to do like natural dyes do. Today we're going to only discuss about things that you can do from your kitchen. Okay. So next one is just 1 second. Why is it not going? Yeah, 1 second. All right. So if this is some information that you can't use right now because you don't have, iron is also what you can actually get from your kitchen. If you have rusted iron nails, you can actually put it in vinegar and water and leave it for 1 week and it becomes your iron mordant. But the nails have to be rusted, or nails or anything which is rusting. So iron rust has a quality of fixing and it also has a quality of changing the color. So it is also called a modifier. For example, if you dyed a fabric in yellow color and then you put it in iron, that fabric will change from yellow to green, or it can change from yellow to gray. That's the quality of iron. It is a fixer as well as it is a mordant. And if you have soaked your fabric in a mordant and then you put it in the dye, then it will change the color of the dye. For example, you took a fabric, put it in iron solution, and then you took it in a yellow dye bath. Then the whole fabric will become green. It won't stay yellow anymore. Alum, on the other hand, fitkari, which you also, if you have in the house, you can use. Alum does not change the color of the dye. It is white in color and it only gives a colorless layer on the fabric. If you're using alum, you cannot use more than 20% the weight of fabric. Okay, so the ideal amount is to use 10%. And if you have iron, if you're using, if you're using iron crystals to make a solution, you can't use more than 2 to 4% the weight of fabric. Can you tell me why? Can you guess why more iron is harmful for the fabric and why we can't use more than 2 to 4%? Anybody can guess if you understand why?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Why we are only using 2 to 4% iron to the weight of fabric? Why we can't use a lot of iron with the fabric?
No, I don't have any idea.
So iron makes the fabric brittle and it can tear. If you use too much of iron, it will make the fabric hard and it will tear. So iron we have to use carefully and small quantity. Okay. Then I'll come back to these are harmful mordants. The equipments that you will need if you want to do dyeing, of course, you need a heat source to be able to boil the dye bath to take out the color. Then we need a mortar and a pestle or a mixer. So if you have any material which you can just use a mortar and pestle also to just coarsely grind it, or you can use a mixer. Then you need a pan to make the mordant and the dye solution. These pans or whatever you're going to container you'll use, they should be non-reactive. By which I mean that if you're using a copper or iron, then it will also give that color of the copper and iron in it. Okay. So the best materials, either plastic or steel. If you have to put it on fire, then steel is better. Or you can use enamel pan as well. Okay. Then a weighing scale is needed because you usually weigh how much of material you're using. Accordingly, you'll take water and accordingly, you'll take your fabric. So weighing scale is also important. Stirring rod, you need again a rod which is glass or steel. We can't use something which has got little iron in it, because whenever you use something with iron, it changes the color of the dye. Remember I told you that if you have an iron bath, then the yellow dye will become green. Like that, all the colors can actually change. If you have a little bit of rust on your spoon or you have an iron spoon, you can't use that. So it's very important to use non-reactive materials. Then a measuring jug or whatever beaker to measure how much water you have to take. Storage container to, after you've made the dye bath, you can actually store it for some days.
Who's ready to hatch some cool pets? Click.
So So dyestuffs can be, they're all natural, right? So just the way your natural fruits and vegetables last for some days, this will also last for some day. After that, there is a fungus layer on the dyes that you will see, which can actually, which doesn't mean that a dye has become bad. You can remove the fungus and still use the dye. But you need to throw it once you see no more color is coming out of the dye bath. And you need various buckets and bowls, of course, to do all kinds of concoctions. Yeah. Okay. So I'll come to the process of now preparing the dye. Okay. The dye extraction process. So basically, if you can see this chart, I'll just make it a little bigger. In a nutshell, this is what you will do with anything. The first step is identify what plant has color. Then you grind it. If you can dry it, it is really good. If you cannot dry it, then you can use a wet one, but you boil it in water. Okay. Next, you will never boil it more than 50, 60 degrees of temperature, which means that you can heat it. Once the temperature is very high, you reduce the flame and simmer the dye material in the water to take out the color. Simmering for a long time, like let's say from 15 minutes to half an hour to 1 hour also, it depends on when you see that the color has come out from the material and the material has become almost like colorless, or you see that the color is there in the thing, then you can stop. Doing it at low flame is always good. Heat it once and then lower the temperature. Why am I saying this is because natural dyes are very sensitive to heat. If you boil at 100 degrees and above, the color will burn and it will become brown and it will probably vanish also. So try doing that. Take out color from a flower, boil it, and then overboil it. And you'll see the color will be completely destroyed. It won't be yellow anymore. Okay. Fourth step. So once you have your dye bath, then what you do is that you prepare your fabric. How you prepare your fabric is that you just soak the fabric in little hot water or lukewarm water with a pinch of soap, liquid soap, okay? Not Surf Excel or anything, liquid soap. When we are using soap in any natural dye process, we will use liquid soap like Easy or Gentle, because Surf is to be used because it has bleach in it. And bleach is very, very, harmful for natural dyes because it will take away the color as well, right? So even when you make a natural dye piece, you should wash it with liquid soap only and not Surf. So when we soak the fabric in water and then we squeeze it, okay? Never take the fabric drip or the piece of fabric which is dripping in water into the dye bath. Then what we do is we first put it in the alum, or you can put it in Harda or pomegranate. All these three things are, mordant as well. So first you mordant and then you put it in the dye bath and then you can dry it. In the mordant, we leave it for, I'll explain everything properly again. Just try to understand this diagram right now. So in any kind of mordant that you're using, you can leave the fabric there for 15 minutes. At least 15 to 20 minutes for the mordant to be absorbed on the fabric. And then you take it in the dye bath, which is already colored, which you've already boiled and, strained the solution. And this will be again 15 to 20 minutes again in the dye bath. You could also take this on fire and slowly heat the solution and the fabric at a very low temperature so that the dye goes faster in the fabric. The purpose is only to increase the reaction and the movement of the molecules. But if you are putting anything on fire, you need to be constantly stirring your fabric. If you leave your fabric and your container on the fire unattended, then some parts of the color will be dark, some part will get burnt, and all those things can happen. So if you're leaving on fire, you have to constantly stir it. And then after you've dyed it, now if you want to actually change the color, then you can put it in iron rust solution, which you can make with iron nails, I told you, and vinegar and water. In our prep list, we've given you how you can, what is the ratio to
be. Is it, sorry, interrupting you. Is it necessary to put before dyeing, we should keep it in rust material?
No. Iron rust you should only use if you want to change the color, modify the color. Otherwise, not.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you want a yellow dye, then keep it only in yellow dye bath and with, you know, harda or alum. Don't use anything else. Now, instead of hartaki and alum, if you don't have this, you can use tea, you can use pomegranate solution for, you know, modenting your fabric, okay? And that is how you will, and then just dry it. Another important thing here is that after you dye, you should dry it for at least 1 day, okay? Why? Because the atmosphere actually develops the color of the fabric. So just dyeing is not enough. The drying part where the air and the atmosphere and sunlight is reacting with your color, that's important for the color to be cooked inside the fabric. But you should never put it under direct sunlight. Direct sunlight is a bleaching agent. So put it in somewhere in the shade, but it should be sunny, like dry it in the daytime. Okay, and then once you've dried it for 1 day, second day you have to actually rinse it first. Rinse means just clean it in water so that any unattached dye can come out, and then you will wash with soap, liquid soap, and in hot water again, and then dry it. That is how your dyeing finishes. Okay, the soaping part in hot water is extremely important because here also that color fixing is happening. So color fixing is actually happening in two stages. One is in the modenting stage, last is in the washing stage. And both these, you have to keep it for 15 minutes, you know, to make sure that it is, so that it's done properly, not do it immediately and take it out. Okay. I'm going to go back in the preparation stage now. We'll start again with the first step. So how do you, your fabric is there, but how do you check if your fabric is ready or not? The fabric has to absorb water to be able to absorb dye. So the way to test a fabric, whether it's ready for dye, is take the fabric and put a few drops of water on it. If the water is absorbed within 3 seconds, then your fabric is excellent and it's ready to dye. If the water is not absorbed after 3 to 10 seconds, then you have to actually wash it in hot water and soap and make it soft and absorbent. Okay? Because the logic is simple. If it is not absorbing water, it will not absorb the dye as well. So sometimes when you have old fabrics, there's no problem. If you take any old fabric and you drop water, you'll see within 3 seconds, it will absorb the water. But if you have a new fabric which you've got from the market, they have a lot of layers of starch and chemicals and things on it. Then you have to actually, and you'll drop water and see it's not absorbing. Then you take hot water, take soap, any kind of soap. Here you can take surf also, because the idea is to bleach and scar the fabric before we can dye. So just take some surf water, boil it, boil the fabric in the water for 15 minutes or half an hour, then rinse it and dry it and then use it. If there is a lot of starch in the fabric, then you can also leave it in water overnight and next day boil it in water. Okay. So this stage is probably very, very important, as much as dyeing is important, that your fabric should be ready to absorb color. Okay. And water. Preparation of mordant. So now when the fabric is ready, you will now prepare your mordant. So you will, whenever you are preparing the mordant, I told you that you should be using 10% alum. Right now, when you're doing it with the kitchen material, you don't have to worry. You can use a little bit of tea. Like you can use 1 spoon of tea in like 1 liter of water. Okay. Or you can use 1 pomegranate peel for 1 liter of water. But when you're doing proper dyeing with measurements, then you have to make a record of how much you're using. Okay. We'll not go into this right now because it's very technical and it should come after you've done some hands-on practice with kitchen ingredients. Okay. So then we are going to, just 1 second. modern thing. So modern thing part is where you are, after you've got your fabric ready, you put it in the modern bath that you have, whether it's tea solution or it's hartaki solution or it's alum solution or it is pomegranate solution. You move the fabric in that modern bath properly so that it is absorbing the modern. Okay. And then you will go for your dyeing. You'll put it, you put the fabric in the dye bath, whatever dyes you've got, you know, whether you have marigold flower dye or you've got, dye from beetroot or from spinach. You can try and see whatever kitchen material has color in it, you can use that to take out the dye. So after that, after modernizing, you're putting the fabric in the dyeing and then you're drying. The same stages which I explained here is what you're going to do. Okay. There are some do's and don'ts about dyeing, which I want to repeat, is that when you're boiling any material, any plant material, it should have enough water, but not too much water. So how do you measure that? Is that the water should soak the material. Suppose you took some flowers, okay, and then you put water that it is completely soaked, and then it could be probably 1 or 2 inches higher than the, you know, material. It's almost similar to cooking rice, like how much water you will take to cook rice, that kind of a thing. And you can heat it up and then just simmer it for 15 to 20 degrees temperature. Don't exceed 50, 60 degrees temperature. And you can also leave the... So when you boil the dye solution, no, you can leave it overnight and dye the next day. Because when you do that, the color becomes very strong than using it immediately. Okay. So like you boil some flowers, you made a dye bath, leave it overnight. Next day, you can strain it and then use it as a dye solution. It will be stronger. Then I think if you are working on the stove and dyeing your fabric on the stove, then you have to be stirring the fabric. Otherwise, you can also dye it in the cold bath, like in the dye solution, which is away from fire. You can put it there. Move your fabric and leave it inside there for it to absorb color. Okay. All right. Now I'll just show some small short videos I want to show you to just see how you soak your fabric and everything. So this is a way you soak your fabric before you dye. All right. One second, and then this is the way you can have small tubs where you can have the dye solution and where you can dye it, and then you hang it in the air, which is in the shade area but not really under direct sunlight, to check your piece. All right, and now I want to show you something interesting, which is like, how can you change the color of things actually? And what is the strongest bleach in nature? Which is very magical and it's especially very interesting for children.
Namrata, can you maximize your screen for the video?
Yeah, actually the thing is that I'm trying to do these.
So on view options on the top, you can put it on the bottom. If you click on this view options,
it's a long video, so that's why it's going to stay like that.
This is a portrait.
Right. Okay. What is the strongest bleach in nature? Can anybody guess and tell me what is a strong bleach in nature?
Vinegar.
Yes. Usse bhi strong hai lemon. Okay. And I want to show you this video, which shows what happens to. So there were two. I'm just going to pause once. The blue pea flower. Do you know it is called Shankh Pushpi? It's a flower which is blue in color. Have you guys seen it? It's called blue pea flower. So we took blue pea flower and we boiled it in a little bit of water. So the flower becomes colorless because the color, if you can see, the glass has got a light blue color in it. Okay. So the water becomes blue and the flower becomes colorless. Now when we put lemon, see what happens. Okay. Can you see? So it's changed to purple. This is blue and the other one is purple. Right? So any acid content, you know, in a material or any alkali content in a material can actually change the color. All right. One second. Just increase it. I'm just going to stop my screen share right now.
So, Namrata, okay.
Yeah, everybody can see me, right? So, if we can just go over and repeat everything from the beginning now, that if you have to extract the color, what do you do? I want people to repeat and tell me how would you extract the color? Say you have to extract the color from tea or from haldi, what would you do?
Who wants to take a try? Shefali, do you want to go ahead?
Yes. Actually, you can repeat the question.
Yeah, if you have to extract the color from any dye material from your kitchen or garden, what would you do?
I have to do it, keep it in warm water. And test the color. And after that, I have to fix the color. For fixing the color, we use the iron one, iron to change the color.
Yeah. But before that, you have to...
We need to keep it in water, dip in water, and moderate should be used to fix the color.
Okay, right. So I'll go over again once now since after all this discussion. So the first part was checking whether the color is there. That's perfect. That you take some hot water, put the ingredient in the put the hot water on the ingredient and check if it is giving out color or not. And for that, you can put a small piece of fabric in that and see if the fabric is catching color or not. If it's catching color, then that material can be used for dyeing or taking out the dye extraction. Then what you do is, suppose you chose a particular leaf or a flower which is giving color. Then you take a lot of ingredient of that to make a color bath. So very small ingredient will not be enough. The amount of color in a particular material is only 5%, which means if you have to take up 5 grams of color, you need 100 grams of that ingredient. That's why you need a weighing scale. Okay. So you get a lot of flowers or a lot of, whatever material you're using, tea or coffee, or you can use beetroot. So probably one beetroot, measure it, how much it is, you know, and then you'll see how much color is, you know, coming out of it. So you take that material and you either dry it and use it, or you can crush it and boil it in hot water. And when you're boiling in hot water, make sure that the water level is above the material and it is not a lot, so that then the color will become really diluted. So extraction of color is really like making tea. You need to simmer it, you need to soak the material and boil it for some time till the color is coming in the solution. If you have flowers and everything, then you'll see that the flowers are going to become colorless because all the color is going to come out in the solution. If you have tea or something, then you will see that the color has reached a level where you can see that the solution has become brown. Or if you have any other color, which is like orange or something, then the solution will become, you know, that particular color which you're boiling. Once you have done that, then you can actually leave it overnight. And next day, you can actually strain it. And when you strain it, you'll get this colored solution, which is your dye bath. But now when we start dyeing, the first step is to soak the fabrics in water. And your fabric has to be ready for dye. How will you check if it's ready for dye? Who can answer that? How do you check if your fabric is ready to dye?
Sorry, I can't.
You take the fabric and drop a few drops of water in it and then check if it's absorbing water or not. See, if you guys have any old fabric right now with you, why don't you take it, drop some water on it and check and tell me within 3 seconds, is it absorbing water or not? Okay. I think, yeah, water drop test.
Yes, okay. If fabric is absorbing water, then it is able to.
So that is a test. And if it's not absorbing water, what do you do? You can't take it for dyeing for sure. So what do you do?
Yes, I think we can use any fixer for before dyeing.
No, first for preparing the fabric, you just need to boil it in hot water and soap. Okay, on a gas.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can... to remove the starch on it.
It's called starch. You can soak it overnight and next day boil it. Boiling has to be done if it's not absorbing water. So take a cauldron of water, boil it, put surf or any detergent in it. Here we are using detergent because we are also going to, because it is hard washing and removing all the chemicals and starch from it. Okay, so you'll put your fabric and you will move the fabric and boil it in this hot water and soap. You can do this for 15 minutes. If it is a lot of, if you still don't see it, like it's becoming soft, then you can do it for half an hour also. Okay. And then rinse it and dry it. And then take it for dyeing purpose. Okay. So that is one thing. You can try with small swatches first. Don't go for big fabric. You can do with small things as well. So now you've got your fabric, which is ready. You've got your dye, which is ready. What is missing? The mordant bath or the fixer bath. For this, you can either make a tea solution or a pomegranate peel solution or a hartaki solution and keep it ready also. All right. So now you actually have your fabric ready, which you can soak it in water before you dye. You never drop a dry fabric in the dye solution. You always should always wet it first. So you keep your fabric ready. Then you have your mordant solution. Then you have your dye solution. And last, you can have your iron solution to change the color. Okay. Or you can also have a lemon solution if you want to change the color. Or, you know, anything which is going to change the pH of the water is what you can keep at the last to change the color. Okay. So first, we take this ready to dye fabric, put it in water, take it out, squeeze it a little bit. And then you take it in the mordant and you move the fabric in the mordant bath and you leave it there for another 15 minutes. The mordant should be absorbed on the fabric, okay? Once that is done, you take it out from there, squeeze it a little bit and then take it in your dye solution. This dye could be anything. It could be from beetroot, turmeric, spinach, tea, coffee, avocados. You can boil anything and make a dye solution. You put it in the dye solution and again, take it in and out, you know, the way you would, you know, do washing. And then you again squeeze it lightly. And then you can either dry it if you want the same color. Or you can take it in the iron solution if you want to change the color. All right. So I want you to imagine and understand this whole, process. And if you're okay with it, I want to show you a few more videos of the dyeing process. Is everybody okay with this process? Is there any question about this?
Yeah, okay.
All right. So I'll just show you some videos again. Hold on. I don't hear anything from the other people. Are you all following or not? I'm not sure. Tamanna, I'm seeing the response. Yeah, just give me 5 minutes. I'll just turn on the video.
I think Dimples.
Could you try again?
Yeah, you were saying something.
No, I was just saying that maybe Dimple's connectivity is weak, probably. She was trying to speak. I know, I think I can see Tamanna and Shefali are responding to questions, but I don't see Dimple much. Also, she's unwell and her connectivity seems to be weak.
No, no, I'm there. I'm very much there. And okay. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. No, I'm there. I am taking down my notes and all also.
Okay, fine. So I'm just, you guys can see my screen now, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm just playing this video.
Hi, welcome to the session of making herbal dye bath. You must have received a beautiful dyeing kit from...
This is with R powders. This is not the one. Sorry, I'm just going to play the other video. Because we are, you're right now doing extraction colors. We have another process in which you can use a ready color that we make, actually. So this was about that. I'll just go back to my video 1 second. Stop share.
So are you ready to go now? Okay.
Okay, I think I'm ready. I'll just put it on the screen share now. Yeah, screen share. Yeah. Okay. So this is a step about modern thing.
All right. So our four herbs are on simmer and they're going to need 1/2 hour each for the color to extract from the herbs into the water. By this time, we're going to get the modern ready. So I'm going to take some water. Around 1/2 liter of water.
This is because we are dyeing very small pieces. And right now you should try with small pieces only.
So the first water is for the fabric. Whenever we do natural dyeing, we always wet the fabric first. Never go dry fabric in the color. So these 10 inches swatches that we've given you, you should put it in the water and let it soak so that it is ready and absorbent to absorb the color. So we're going to take 7 pieces and put them in the water. Organic cotton or any natural fabric is good for natural dyeing. We do not recommend you to use synthetic fabrics. I'm going to add some more water so that the fabrics can be soaked nicely. In natural dyeing, every step is very important so that your color comes even. The soaking of the fabric has to be done thorough. All right. Now I'm going to make the solution of alum, which is basically a salt of aluminium. And this is present in the soil naturally. So it is not at all toxic. When you throw this water in the soil, it doesn't make it toxic. the amount of alum to be added to the water is approximately 10 to 15% the weight of water. And now I'm going to add the iron. Iron, you have to be very careful with it. Iron can turn everything black. So when you use a separate spoon and do not touch this iron hand on any of the other colors. So I'm going to take this salt has to be taken 3 to 5% of the weight of water. So very little bit of iron. And I'm going to take a spoon to mix it. Can you see it's already turned a little blackish? Do not put your fingers in this because otherwise you're going to stain everything else. And now I'm going to mix the alum. You must be wondering why are we using two kinds of mordant. So alum is basically for all the light colors and to keep the shades lighter and brighter. When you want to make the shades darker, you actually go from alum into iron. So a fabric which is yellow here will become green or black here. And I will show you the magic as we proceed. Okay, this is for now. Let's go and check what is happening to our herbs. So now I'm going to take my boiled madder and haori solution and I'm going to sieve it in this container. I like to use this because in this planter, my sieve gets stuck and I don't have to hold it. So look at this. This is a residue after boiling madder and wood flour and sieving the solution. Now, this is an excellent manure for your soil. As we all know, in natural dyes, there is no waste. So I have my pomegranate dye bath ready here. I'm going to take out my fabric from the alum. It was there for 15 minutes. I'm going to squeeze it, open it nicely, and go in the pomegranate dye bath. I'm going to let it soak for another 15 minutes before taking it out. I will take out another piece because I'm going to show you how the color changes from alum to iron. So I have two pieces that I have dipped in the pomegranate dye bath and we will check it after 15 minutes.
So you don't just leave the fabric. 15 minutes are over. Sorry, 1 second, I'll just pause here. When you drop the fabric in the dye bath, after a few minutes, you again come and rotate it and move it. Don't just drop the fabric and leave it unattended. Okay.
I'm going to slightly squeeze the fabric. I can see a beautiful yellow color. Can you see this? This is your pomegranate peel color. And now we're going to hang it and let it dry. Now I will go for my next piece, lightly squeeze the beautiful yellow fabric, open it again, and go in the iron. Are you ready for magic now? See how the color is going to change. It's a beautiful green color. The same yellow, which has changed to green because of the iron mordant. Now we will hang this piece.
Okay, so yeah, this is a basic way how you will do your dyeing. And you can take out color from various materials. As we said, you can use spinach, you can use beetroot, you can use turmeric, and you can try to find some new colors if you have a garden and what ingredients do you have there that you can try to make out color from. But all of these are very, very elementary. Some of these colors may not stay very long. Expect them to fade or vanish after some time. If you want to do natural dyeing with natural sources which are been tested and which are very already known to give colors that are going to stay, you have to refer to the materials I told you, madder, hartaki, pomegranate peel. Onion peel is also something that you can use and will stay. Okay. Not all the colors which come once on the fabric may stay. They can actually vanish after some time. And see that also, that's also very interesting. Dye something with beetroot, dye something with beetroot and a fixer, like, you know, maybe a tea bath and then beetroot. Dye something probably pomegranate peel. And then all these swatches, leave them in your book or anywhere sometime and watch it, what happens after 1 week. I think only doing can give you that experience about what is happening with the colors. So the one that did not have a fixer would have faded actually after wash only. And the one that has a fixer is going to stay, but maybe after some time of exposure to, you know, air and everything, they can vanish. But the one which is from pomegranate peel, that will probably stay longer than the one with the beetroot. So all these, you have to just make your own observations and, you know, check.
How can we use beetroot?
Go ahead, Chipali.
Yeah, I want to ask about beetroot. How can we use as a dye beetroot?
You can grate it. So anything has to be made smaller. So you can either chop it and mixer, you can do a mixer, turn the mixer, boil it and do it. Or you can just grate it and then boil it in water.
Okay.
Yeah.
Namrata, can you make colors like parrot green from anything natural?
So parrot green, there is no green color in nature, by the way. The amount of green that we see around, there is no ingredient in nature which gives green color. To make green color, you actually have to use either a modifier, or if you want that bright color you're saying, you have to use yellow plus indigo. So anything in nature, if you have to make it green, you have to do yellow and then indigo, which is blue. So yellow plus blue is equal to green. That's how it functions. And indigo making is not something that you can just do from your kitchen. You need specific materials in a specific measurement to make indigo dye bath. And if you want to join our indigo workshop, Art Circle will tell you when we're having the workshop that you can do. You need to buy the indigo material and the lime and everything which is needed with it to make an indigo dye bath.
And I think apart from indigo, terracotta is another natural color which is quite widely used.
If you have that red matti, geru matti bolte hai jisko, if you have that, you can again soak it in water. So matti, you don't have to really boil it. Plant material you need to boil because you want to extract the color. But matti, if you just soak it in water and take the water layer from the top, it is good enough.
But then will the matti color last?
If you do alum and then geru, it'll last. It won't last very long. See, any of these experiments, what I'm saying, are more to see of how color comes out. And they are very temporary. If you want to make something which is wearable and, you know, which is like it will stay longer, then you have to stick to the ingredients which are very commonly, which have been tested and been used in natural dyes, which is like madder, hartaki, pomegranate peel, all those things. And those also fresh ones, if you take from nature and do, you can learn, but you can't really make it last longer. You have to take it from the specific dye people who are selling these ingredients for dye purposes. You can also buy it from a store if you want. But they're very good to work with children also, because they just need to see whether the color is coming out or not. And, you know, and then they can they're not serious dyers, so they can work with any kitchen ingredient. And for you also to get started on natural dyeing, this is very nice to start from your kitchen and get your own experience of what is happening to the color after some days. if you don't use a fixer, and if you use something else like lemon, what happens? This is, I mean, natural dyeing is you have to get into a mode of being a scientist and examine what is happening and then make your notes along with that. That okay, this is what happens if I did this. Try to put a colored piece into and put a rusted nail near it, and then you see what happens. The whole thing will get, you know, it'll have black spots on it. So, yeah. Any other question that anybody has? Shefali says she likes his green color. Yeah.
So yeah, that green color is my favorite. Sap green, like.
So you can make some yellow from yellow flower, maybe marigold. Marigold is a good, very good source of bright yellow color. So you can get some marigold flowers, just break them open, you know, take out the petals, soak them in water, and then boil it in water and take out the solution. Strain the fabric, strain the color, and then dip the fabric in first mordant, and then in the color, and then in this iron solution, which you can make with rusted nails and vinegar, and you will get color. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Just follow the stepwise. First water, then mordant, then water, and then drying, and then washing. All the five. Okay. And washing always to be done next day, not on the same day.
Okay. Okay. Because I'll do that.
Atmosphere really needs to develop the color, whatever you're doing. Your dyeing is not completed in the dye bath. The atmosphere and the air and the sunlight has an important role to play in the development of and cooking of color.
Okay. So every color, every after dye, we should keep the fabric in the sunlight.
Yes. Yes. Not direct sunlight, under shade. Okay.
Okay.
But
okay.
It should be daytime, right?
Okay.
Yeah. Because solar heat is what? It cooks the color very slowly, right? Which is very good for natural dyes. If you do anything sudden and harsh, dyes, you know, are very, very sensitive, natural dyes especially, and they react and they'll become uneven or they'll become discolored or whatever. But sun's heat is very soft, and it comes slowly, and it, you know, develops over time. So if you're doing anything natural, if you have time, then it is always better to do it in that process.
So I think, Namrata, this brings us towards to the end of the session, I
yes.
assume.
Yeah.
Okay. I would like if, you know, you guys, Tamanna, Dimple, Shefali, if you have any, what has been your experience? What's your experience from these 2 days session? If you want to share some pointers for us, it'll be great. Even for like what you would like to do in future as next sessions, is this session good enough for you and you want to carry forward this learning with future sessions? Or there is something that you would want to improve in this experience. Please share your experience with us.
Thanks, Prerna. Actually, I was a little busy. I want to attend this session, but I was not ready properly. But Prerna insisted me and told me to join the session. So I joined it, and I find it very, very informative. And बहुत सारी चीजें ऐसी थी थैंक यू नमिता देयर वर सो मेनी थिंग्स जो मुझे फर्स्ट टाइम मैंने जाना और नॉलेज हुआ मुझे लाइक यस्टरडे यू टुक द सेशन अबाउट सस्टेनेबिलिटी एंड मोर मेनी थिंग्स एंड इट वाज नॉलेजेबल एंड यूजफुल फॉर मी सो थैंक यू सो मच It was a very knowledgeable and effective session you took. And I'll definitely try to do this. And that marigold and green color, I will definitely try and maybe share with you too.
Yeah. I really recommend that aap log jo seekha hai, usse to just play with this experience and try it in your, you know, own time. And then we can take you to the next session, which is like working with the proper herbs, which are known to give color, doing the process properly. It is all step-wise that you can learn, you know. Yeah, but this is very good to start.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Even for me, and it's a good start. So initially, I'm going to go and get all the, you know, whatever fish, a few kitchen ingredients, and, you know, hunt for a few things, practice it, and then go in for the next workshop.
Yeah. So playing with colors and experimenting are two core things you have to be open to if you want to learn natural dyeing.
Right.
I hope that you guys will do something, and please share some photos in the WhatsApp group that is there.
Okay. No, definitely.
On interesting accidents and discoveries also. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I'll do that.
Yeah, we'll keep the WhatsApp group open for a while. And so, you know, we would like to see how you progress from this one workshop. I mean, we don't want to just end it at this, just doing two, you know, sessions. But it'll be great to see the learning coming out of it.
No, that's exactly what even I've decided to do a lot of these small things, put them up on Instagram and WhatsApp, and, you know, then take it forward from there.
You know, Namrata, I want to share something. Actually, I was before 2-3 months before, I was trying to do something natural dye. Actually, my husband is a principal scientist, or he is working on grapes. So he it's a big amount of grapes at my place. It was a grape, wine color grape. So okay. I thought I should try it, and I squeezed the grapes on a t-shirt and kept it on a steamer that used for momos.
Yeah.
So the color was good. Initially, it was light purple and all, and I kept it in shade to dry it, and after washing, whole colors were gone and my t-shirts were spoiled. So now I'll try it in better manner. I learned it from you. So it was it was like spoiling my t-shirt.
Yeah, right.
Thank you.
With the fun and the curiosity increase, so you did this workshop, which is nice.
Yes.
Thank you, Tamanna, for your lovely and kind feedback. And I hope that you'll also go a little deeper and do more learning in this field. We are only getting started. Huh? Yeah.
Okay. So I think that's about it. Thank you so much, Namrata, for your time. There's so much to learn from you.